so. It tells me so.
And we will follow on from there. The song I'm going to render is Goodness of God. Feel free to sing along with me, as I believe you should know the song. I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. All my days have been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. Darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, running after me. Your goodness is running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after me. Your goodness is running after me. Your life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after me. And all my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. 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 Hallelujah. This will be followed by the video tributes.
Dear Granny Joyce, it's been one of the hardest things to lose you because you meant so much to me. You're in my heart and that's where you'll always be. I know that heaven called you and I wish you could have stayed. But I know that the memories we have will never fade. We all knew it was time for you to go home so that all the pain you had could go away. But I want you to remember one thing. We're not apart. You will always be with us in our memories and in our broken hearts.
Hey, Granny, I just wanted to say thank you. Thank you for being such an amazing woman, such an amazing grandmother. Just thank you for everything that you were to our lives. You were an amazing person. I want to say thank you for teaching me that there is power in silence and there is pride in humbleness. And I want to say that I'm going to miss you so much. I don't think there's anything that will fill that void that you will leave, but I'm going to miss just the look on your face after months away overseas, coming home and seeing you smile. I'm going to miss your hugs. I'm going to miss your love. I'm going to miss your food. I'm just going to miss the way you held my hand, or you would hold my hand when I would walk you up the stairs, or I would walk you from church. I'm going to miss everything about you, Granny. And I just want to say that this is not our loss. This is heaven's gain. And until then, it's till we meet again. I love you, Granny.
My granny was a great cook. She would always have us in the kitchen with her on evenings or mornings, doing breakfast, lunch, sometimes dinner. We used to make curry chicken, fried rice, macaroni pie on Sundays, baked chicken. She always had us there on her, which inspired me to like go into doing like cooking and stuff. I like cooking because of my granny. Yeah, and I went to school for cooking.
Granny's cooking inspired me. Even though I'm like far from home, it's like I always try to replicate the same dishes that she makes, but it's never like the same. Like it's more, whenever like I eat the food that Granny makes at home, it like it's more like homey and authentic than when I make it. So like that always like resonates with me, you know? But I always try to like get it as close to home as possible, like how Granny would make it back home. And like that's just something that I miss about like Granny in the whole, like in general, is like her cooking.
I'm Blake Clark. I'm one of Joyce's many grandchildren. Seeing her move on, I know she's gone to a better place. She's not in pain anymore. And like I said, we're granted 90 years on the face of the earth, so. Gran got ill sudden. Gran got ill sudden, so it was like a shock to us. Because Gran is a lady that's strong. She goes over in the yard every morning, does her cleaning, she washes, she cooks. To see Gran like that, no, it was, as they said, it was a shocker. Although Gran is gone, she's still here. She's with all of us. I told her the most important thing before she go, and that was the leper.
My name is Sandra, and I am the eldest daughter of Joyce Alleyne. Mom really liked cooking, and of such till unto this day, I always remember Mom when she cooked baked chicken. I could never get it the way how she cooked it, and I always want to taste it the way how she want, but I never get it to taste the way that way. But by such, it will happen one day. And Mom, as we grew up together, in addition, there were other children that Mom mind, and we would all come to her home. And if we would say that we had a friend and the friend was in need somewhere to stay, we just go and tell Mom, and she said, oh, bring them along. And we all hold together in the house. And we will cook and eat and everything.
It would have been in the 1980s, 70s, 80s, right? When we were all teenagers, we would visit each other's house. Like I would spend... Me and my sister, with Valerie, would spend time over at Uncle George and Aunt Joyce with their kids, or they would come vice versa, spend time with us over the West Coast in Guyana. And we all grew up as one family. There was never any distinction. I remember when we were in our adolescence, probably in our 20s, Sharon lived at us for about probably a year or over. And same thing, we were always treated as one. There was never any distinction. And this is why I saw it fitting. It's heartbreaking to hear of the death, and I saw it fitting to go to the funeral because I see myself as living at that house and living with that lady for some time. All right, because even when we went to Barbados for the family reunion, she remembered us, and the kind of welcome we got was no different to when we were in Guyana.
Even if people don't remember us as Miss Alleyne, they always remember Buns' lady daughter. She always make a good main buns. She was just there. She's just mommy all the time, always at home. Good housewife.
3 weeks ago, she said, listen, I live my life. I'm ready to go home. She said, Mom, she said, listen, I raised 6 kids. I see my grandkids. I know my great grands. I did enough. You know, so I know my mother went home and she's comfortable. She's happy. I'm quite sure people who go to view her is going to see she's at rest and she's, you know, she's happy where she at today.
My name is Dennis Greenwich. I am the fourth cousin of our late husband. Our late husband, mother and my mother were 2 sisters. And may she rest in peace. All the best. And I ask all our relatives to have faith in God. I know death is inevitable, but at the same time, when it comes, we cannot bear it. Life or death, life is like a story. It's like a story. Never mind how long a story is, it has an end. Although we know life has an end, when it comes, we seldom want to accept it. That is a human nature. But we have to accept it. My deepest sympathy to all, my deepest sympathy. I share your sorrow. Share your sorrow. Cousin Joyce, have an eternal rest, and may you find a place in the right hand of God. And may God have mercy upon your soul, and you rest in peace. Rest in peace. And all those who are left behind her, all those who are still remaining, I will like them to take a leaf from our book. Take a leaf and follow in our footsteps. Follow our way of our life. And that we may that live an exemplary life. And my deepest sympathy.
Dear Granny Joyce, it's been one of the hardest things to...
Good morning. Please stand as we shall now sing the processional hymn, And Can It Be?
Bold I approach the eternal Eternal God and our Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning through your Son, Jesus Christ. We come to you at the invitation to come boldly to your throne that we may find grace to help in the time of need. And Father, as we have come today to say thank you for the life of our sister Joyce Alleyne, we know, God, that their hearts here that are grieving, they are bereaved because they will miss a loved one. So, Father, we lift them to your throne of grace today. We pray especially for her sister Jean. We pray, God, for her children, for her grandchildren. We pray, God, for other relatives and friends today. Lord, that even now that they will sense that underneath of them are your everlasting arms supporting and comforting and strengthening them at this time. Lord, we pray that your blessing, your anointing will rest upon this service, every part of it, Lord, and that even as we give it to you, that it will be used to be a source of comfort and strength to those who are here. We thank you, Lord, and we praise you, and we ask that even in this service of thanksgiving, where we celebrate life and consider death, that someone today will find life. These things we pray and ask in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Please be seated. We will now have the first scripture reading, taken from the book of Revelation, chapter 21, verses 1 to 8. And to be read by Sandra Goodluck Semple.
From the book of Revelation, chapter 21, verses 1 to 8. And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepare as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow, nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. And he that sat upon the throne said, behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, write, for these words are true and faithful. And he said unto me, it is done. I am the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is athirst of the fountain of water of life freely. He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son. But the fearful and unbelieving and the abominable and the murderers and the whoremongers, and the sorcerers, and the idolaters, and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. Here ends the reading. Thanks be to God.
Let's stand as we shall have a session of praise and worship. God is a good God. Praise Him when the sun goes down. We have an anchor. And what a beautiful name.
God is a good God, yes He is. 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 He picked me up and turned me around. He placed my feet on solid ground. He picked me up and turned me around. Let my feet on solid ground. God is a good God. Yes, He is. God is a good God. Yes, He is. God is a good God. Yes, He is. God is a good God. Yes, He
picked me up.
He picked me up and turned me around. He placed my feet on solid ground. He picked me up and turned me around. He planted my feet on solid ground. God is a good God. Yes, He is. God is a good God. Yes, He is. God is a good God. Yes, He is. God is a good God. Yes,
He picked me up.
He picked me up and turned me around. On solid ground.
He picked me up.
Oh, yes, He
and
did.
Turned me around. He planted my feet on solid ground.
God is a good God.
Yes, He is.
God is a good God. Yes, He is. God is a good God. Yes, He is. God is a good God. Yes, He is. Praise Him. Praise Him, praise Him, praise Him when the sun goes down.
Oh, praise Him,
praise Him,
hallelujah,
praise Him.
We've got to praise Him
in the morning, praise Him in the noontime. Praise Him, praise Him, praise Him when the sun goes down.
Come on, listen to the verse. Love Him, love Him,
love Him. Love Him, love Him, love Him when the sun goes down.
Oh, love Him,
love Him, love Him, love Him in the morning,
love Him in the noontime.
Love Him, love Him, love Him when the sun goes down.
His name is Jesus.
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 Jesus in the morning,
Jesus in the noontime,
Jesus,
Jesus, Jesus when the sun goes down.
Oh, we have an anchor that keeps us soul,
steadfast and sure while the billows roll,
fastened to the rock which cannot move, grounded firm and deep in the Savior's
love.
When the strong tides lift and the cables strain,
will your anchor drift off?
Come on, let's declare this morning.
We have an anchor that keeps us soul, steadfast and sure,
the billows roll,
fastened to the rock which cannot move, grounded firm and deep in the Savior's love.
Will your anchor hold
when the surge is right, and the wild winds blow, shall the angry waves or your bark overflow.
Oh, we have an anchor that keeps us all steadfast and sure.
The billows roll,
oh yeah, fastened to the rock, which cannot move, grounded firm and deep in the Savior's love. Will your anchor hold in the floods of death, when the waters call to your latest breath? On the rising tide, you can never fail,
while your anchor holds within the wheel. We have an anchor that keeps us all steadfast and sure.
Worship him this morning, amen.
Name.
death could not hold you.
Death could not hold you. The veil tore before you. You silenced the voice of sin and the rain. The heavens are roaring. The praise of your glory. For you are raised to life again. You have no rival. You have no equal. Now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom. Yours is the glory. Yours is the name above all.
What a powerful name.
What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is.
Continue to worship his holy name. We will now have a tribute given by Lance Myers. And after the tribute, we will have the second scripture reading taken from the book of Corinthians chapter 15, verses 51 to 58, and read by Thea Semple.
Blessed good morning to each and every one of you. Gathered here with us to celebrate the life of one of the most amazing women that you can ever meet on this planet. I greet those of you that are streaming out from Guyana, those that are streaming from North America, from Europe. I greet you in the wonderful name of Jesus, and I count it a great privilege and honor to have the opportunity to share a tribute on behalf of my beloved mother. I don't like to use the term mother-in-law because some in-laws has become outlaws, and I've never had the opportunity to have the outlaw part of our relationship with Joyce. As mentioned, my name is Lancelot. They call me Charles. They call me Lance. They call me Myers, Mr. Myers, but my name is Lance. I met Mom approximately 47 years ago. Could you imagine that, how fast time goes? All via through a young lady by the name of Merlin Myers, Alan Myers. I don't like to share the story a whole lot, but at some point in time, I will get a chance to share if it's whether I was kidnapped or hijacked at 11, 12 years old. But we will share that story another time. But I met Mom via Merlin 47 years ago. We were at school, first form, second form. You know, we were in a very good friendly relationship. As you know, sometimes you go to school and somebody see you and like, I had the opportunity and the privilege. However, one day we had a party to go to, and I invited Merlin out. She told me she had to come and I have to come and ask her parent to come out with me to the party, for her to come to the party. So there where I paid a visit to the home and invited Merlin to the party. On arriving at the home, I met her mom, her dad as well, I think. I'm sure I did meet him. But the visit was very short, brief. You know, at that time, you're very nervous going to invite someone, young daughter, out to a party at that young age. So it was a quick and a short in and out. I don't remember exactly the words I exchanged, but later I heard from Merlin that the entire household was laughing at the speed at which I came and exited. Over the years, as Merlin and I continued our relationship and later got married at a young tender age of 22, I got to know Mom better, and I must report that she was a wonderful mother. When I think of the contented woman, when you think of a contented woman, you do not have to look very far or think too hard. Mom demonstrated the spirit of contentment. During these latter years of her life, this became more evident as I conducted errands for her. One of these was going to the supermarket every month to purchase groceries, a chore I really enjoyed. Her list was always the same, very short and consistent. I would inquire from her whether she was sure that the list was completed, and she would always say to me, "Yes, Lance, this is what I need." Very pleasant, you know. Her words were so charming. How she called me Lance was amazing, how she pronounced me at Lance. But she would always say, "No, Lance, I got what I needed." In the early years of our marriage, for about 17 years plus, Merlin and I lived two houses away from Mom and was privileged to see her every day. For most of these years, she decided that we were too busy with work, and she took on a responsibility to cook for us, and every day she would have hot meals, as we all heard on the testimonies. She really a good cook, very much so. Hot meals to eat every day. Later, she included child care service as needed. Of course, you've seen all the granddaughters around and all the grandsons around. She played a very important role in raising each and every one of them. Mom was a very industrious and a hard-working, peaceful, and contented woman. One could call on her at any time of the day and night, and she would always be available. Mom had always been there for the entire family and took pride in ensuring that she stayed in touch with each and every one of the family members, both at home and abroad, and would always WhatsApp us early in the mornings. And I have never shared this before, but just within the last recent week, I was going through my phone, and I recognized that even during the course of Mom's illness for the last few weeks, she was trying to call me. I was in Atlanta, and I never really recognized the phone, because she didn't know what the phone call, but I saw the numbers that she was trying to call me even while I was away. Maybe just to say to us, you know, that you know she was there going under. Whenever I paid her a visit, Mom always had a visitor in our home. The house is always full of her grandchildren around her. She seems to like had magnet or honey or something that attracted everyone. Every time you go, you will never find her home, her alone. She always would have someone of the family members, some of the grandchildren running around. Today I confess I have been truly blessed to have had three of the most amazing women in my life to call mother. My mom, Joan Myers, my mother-in-law, Joyce, and her wonderful twin sister, Jean. So I have had three J's, three Joans, three Joys in my life. Joan, Jean, and Joyce. You will note, I do not refer to Mom as my mother-in-law, as I do not see her in any different way as Mom. She is my mom. Mom always had a ready smile for me. And if I took too long to visit, I will get a phone call inquiring after my well-being. Always, she would always call, "Lance, how are you doing?" As soon as I miss a week or two and she didn't hear me, she would always be calling me up. Mom never called with a demand to any of us. And if she did need something and we were busy, she would wait until we were available. As she progressed in age, we could see her slowing down physically, but not mentally. I enjoyed conversing with her, and although she was 90 plus, she loved reading the nation newspapers every day and was well-versed on any topic. Anything you could ask Mom about politics, whatever it is, Mom knew everything about what was going on at that tender age of 90. Yep, she had a regular routine, and every day around 8:30 in the morning, I would hear the phone ring, and if you ask if she was at anything, then she would reply, "No, I just want to hear your voice." Mom loved the Lord and was unhappy when she could not no longer attend church as she used to be before, because of arthritis in her feet and later COVID-19 pandemic and the lockdown. She looked forward every Sunday morning to stream in the services. As and I leave the service, sometimes I pass through by her, and she'd always say, Lance, I saw the service. It was a good service. She always used the time to stream. Thank God for the streaming service. Mom took ill suddenly, and within 1 week, one to two weeks of her being ill, she was gone. She lived, she died a very peaceful life. During the week of Mom's being ill, she asked us to call Pastor Jewel to come and visit her, her favorite pastor. And boy, she was so happy when Pastor Jewel arrived. It was a joy to see her expression on her face and the response to the reading of the word and prayers and the singing as Pastor and Sister Deborah prayed and sang with her. She prayed and sang right along with a happy smile on her face. Today I want to say, we do not mourn as those without hope, for we know that she is going to be with the Lord. We know this because she spent that entire week affirming her relationship with him in songs and praises. She was alert and aware of her surroundings to the very end and took time to tell everyone individually that she loved them. I'm thankful to have had the opportunity to spend the last weeks with her, days and hours with Mom. Throughout those last days, whenever I visited, I would participate in prayer with her. On the evening before she went home to be with the Lord, while praying with her, she held my hands in a very tight grip and mouthed, I love you, Lance. Within my spirit, I understood what she meant. I believe this was her way of saying our final goodbye. Early the following morning, after the 3:34 about, our home phone rang, and I knew exactly what it was, that call, about. For the night, I could not sleep, and I had spent the entire night awake, restless, whilst lying in another room. When Merlin came over to inform me that Mom had gone on to be with the Lord. Just as Mom lived, Mom died, quietly and with no fanfare. May her soul rest in peace and may she rise in glory until we meet again, Mom. Farewell. I just want to ask us to also continue to pray for her twin sister, Sister Jean, Mom Jean. We know that they both live very, very closely from the same womb and all the way through until now, the last moment she was spent with her sister. They were very, very close twin sisters. So I want us to remember her in prayer as we continue to celebrate the journey of our dear beloved Joyce. God bless you and enjoy the rest of the celebration.
Good morning, everyone. Today, I will be reading 1 Corinthians 15, verses 51 to 58. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall all be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and all this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the glory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Here ends the Bible reading.
We will now have the eulogy read by Melissa Farnham. And after the eulogy, we will have a solo by Cherianne Walcott.
morning. On this day, some 18 years ago, on June 21st, 2004, I stood on this stage and read the eulogy of Joyce Alleyne, my beloved grandfather, the husband of my grandmother, Joyce Alleyne. I am Melissa, Merlin's daughter, the first grandchild of these two beautiful souls. Today, they will be reunited, and we'll lay her to rest with Granddad's remains. Granny was born to the late Reginald Theophilus Alleyne and Annie Eliza Alleyne on August 16, 1931. She was the last of seven children, all of whom have already gained their wings, with the exception of her identical twin, Jean. The two were inseparable from conception. They were the babies of the family, and the twin was adored and spoiled by their older siblings and parents. Granny would always say, "If you mess with me, you mess with my sister. What affects her affects me too." There were two peas in a pod. There is nothing that they did not do together. They attended the same schools. They held similar jobs in the same company. And if that is not enough, they married two brothers. Therefore, they had the same surnames. They lived under the same roof with their respective husbands. And after they got married, the two of them combined had 10 children. That's not all. In some instances, they gave birth to the children around the same time. And both suffered the same health challenges. One was skinny. When one was skinny, the other was fat, and vice versa. Finally, the day came where, for a few years, the sisters separated, and Granny moved to her new home in Tugville. That didn't change a thing. When the children didn't like what Granny cooked for lunch, they would ride over to Auntie Jean's house to find nothing but disappointment because the exact same thing was cooked over there too. Now, you know, back then there was no cell phones and landlines was a luxury. So there was no way that they could communicate with each other to say what they had, were going to prepare that day. They wore the same clothes, often tricking the children. The only way that we as grandchildren could tell them apart was the little knot on Granny's forehead or the sound of their step. One walked a little lighter than the other. One was also feistier than the other. And you guessed it, the quiet one, as quiet as she looked, Granny was the feisty one. She didn't care what came out of her mouth. She didn't mix matters. She said what had to be said, and that was that. She always told us, don't back down, answer them. The sisters moved back permanently to Barbados in 1994 under one roof again. Granny was many names to people. To some, she was Miss Alleyne. She was Miss Joyce, Joyce-o, Granny, Mum, Aunt Joyce, Buns Lady. Hands down, she made the best buns in the neighborhood. While reflecting and writing this eulogy, I think it was safe for me to say that Granny was an octopus. There was no way that one person could have done all that she had done for her family and to give them the best life without having multiple hands. Granny was not one of academia, but she was a perfect example of Proverb 31, a virtuous woman. These qualities became more prevalent after she got married and decided to quit her job as a seamstress. She was an entrepreneur. She would wake early in the dark of the morning while the kids were asleep to go to the market to make sure that she had the groceries for the home as well as her shop to fulfill her food orders. She would make two sets of food and send my mom to one location, and you better believe by noon everything was sold out. Meanwhile, she stood at home selling, and she would be cooking throughout the day to replenish her stock. She baked the best breads and buns in a fridge. The innovative side of her removed the insulation and the plastic shelves from an old fridge. She lined it with some galvanized and a wired rack shelf. From
chows from an old oven and lit it with a coal pot inside. She would also make and sell pastries and sweet delicacies loved by the school children and those of the neighborhood, in addition to selling homemade ice, coals, and raising chickens. By the end of the day, all of the children would gather and sit down as a family and count bags of money. Granny was resourceful. She sewed everything for the children to wear. All uniforms were homemade. She was nurturing and did everything for them. She never allowed them to press their own clothes, and she would use the coal pot iron to press them. She took this habit to her grandchildren. And all I can say to my husband, Carrie, is her fault. Sorry. Even with the plants, she had a gift. She would revive any dying plant with her green thumb. Granny was generous. Money would trust from her, and wouldn't pay their debt. And when you asked her if they had paid yet, she would say, let it go, it's okay. And she would still sell to them regardless. She had such a debt and love to humanity that even one Christmas day, a man came to the house with a dollar, asking for a dollar's worth of chicken. In those times, with a big family, everyone fought for their favorite part of the chicken. Granny fed the man the children's Christmas dinner. To this day, they still fuss about it. Granny was a real granny, not like those modern day grannies that are all young and stuff. She became a granny in her 50s. So that was the real, real granny. Before she moved back to Barbados, Mom would send us to Guyana for the summer. Those are the best ever, because granny was spoiled as rotten. We would get to bathe in the rain, in just undergarments, cook mud pies, do bush cooks, go to the shop alone, ride bicycles in the streets, and play with the neighborhood kids, all of which mommy would never let us do. She had a hand at raising all of the grandchildren, not only us, but an array of neighborhood children. So the mothers could go to work or to school, and she kept them while running her shop. It was almost as though she had a mini daycare. I'm told that she had found a child that was unable to go to school because she had to stay home to watch her siblings. Unknown to that mother, Granny told the child to bring her siblings to her to keep them so that she could go to school and she'd watch them for free. I'm sure that that child is forever grateful this day because she has taken up that compassion taught to her when she chose her field in nursing. She welcomed all of our friends that was brought to the house, and everyone was well fed. Y'all heard all about her cooking. Despite having 6 children in a 2-bedroom house, she adopted family members and to live with her so that they could pursue their education for that period of time. One of her favorites was Winston, her sister's son. She labeled him as the eldest son to her and was beyond happy to see him move on to have a successful career and raise his own family along with the love of his life, Stephanie. Granny, who was so overwhelmed, Granny was so welcoming that any stray animal that wandered its way to her property, I mean from a dog, a cat, a duck, you name it, once it came onto her property, it became an Alleyne too. Her home was a place of refuge to many. I've heard stories where many women who were victims of domestic violence would come running to her house while being chased. You better believe that man dare not come to her doorstep to get the lady. Though peaceful by nature, she was a protector of her family. There was an instance of an altercation where a neighbor had threatened to harm her kids, and you better believe them kids went to school and back untouched because Granny had her pot of hot water waiting just in case. We all felt that heavy hand and anything else she could get her hands on, especially the guava whip, a wire cane, or a frame belt. She was a firm believer of if you spare the rod, you spoil the child. We can all testify that she had us running at some point. Even before giving her life to Christ, Granny instilled Christ in her children and ensured that the kids would go to Seventh-day Adventist Church on Saturday, and then on Sunday, that bus was coming to pick them up for Sunday school. Baptized in 1993, she never looked back. She was the happiest person for this moment. Granny loved the Lord. Every day, I would see my grandmother in the Word reading her scriptures or praying. She was always early for church to the point that she stopped coming with us because she said we were too late. She'd make my uncle or my aunt drop her off instead. I could see her sitting on the pews over there. And when we got home from church, I would say, Granny, it made me shame, man. You was there mumbling them words. Or I see it breaking off your neck. Most recently, every Sunday, she would call my cousin Tia to turn on the TV, and she was streaming church due to the COVID restrictions. On her dying bed, there was a glow in her face as the pastors came to visit. She was ready to go home, to see her maker. She even tried to pray along with them. And was speaking much, although she wasn't speaking much at that point. Seeing Granny, Granny was still mumbling. She enjoyed a game of cricket and doing daily crossword puzzles to keep her brain sharp, just like her mouth. She kept abreast with the daily affairs, and she always read a newspaper or watched the 7 o'clock news. Actually, as children, not a sound could be made between the hours of 6 and 8 p.m. She and Aunt Jean would watch Days of Our Lives and the news, and God keep quiet. Granny never let her age define her. She loved to cook, and even to this age, she was still independent. She cooked her own food, cleaned the house, washed her clothes. She was up to the time and would call us daily on WhatsApp on her cell phone. Yes, I said it, she had a cell phone. She would go down the list of names on her contacts and call everyone every day. I could hear her know, just give me a little shout. I ain't want nothing, just want to hear your voice. I would truly miss those chats and those family stories that she always told me. She also enjoyed FaceTiming her great-grandchildren, the little ones. Right down to a couple days before she passed, she had asked me for a new phone because the one that she had wasn't working properly. It was kind of dropping calls. She needed to stay in touch with us. That was very important to her. But she was sure to tell me she wanted the same exact phone she had because she wasn't trying to learn another new one. She never forgot a birthday or an anniversary of anyone. She was the family's calendar. We depended on her to find out whose day it was today. You could look forward to the first call coming from Gran. Just a week before she passed, she gave me one last happy birthday, Melissa. Her love for us was immeasurable, equal, and evident. No matter how much you asked Granny, am I your favorite? She would smile. You couldn't catch her slipping. She would smile, and she said, I love you all the same. I have no favorites. Right to the last day on earth, she spent the entire day letting us know how much she had loved us. Everyone would call just to hear her say, I love you one last time. She's a testimony that hard work does not kill anyone. Granny worked like a horse and lived 2 months shy of 91 years old. She raised 6 children and was blessed with 13 grandchildren and 10 great-grandchildren. She was able to do and did everything and anything to make sure that her home was well taken care of. I am proud of what she has done in my life to make me who I am today. I have definitely found my strength and my resilience from her. She is the glue that kept us together and brought our family to where we're at today. The determination and drive that we have comes from her. Granny, your wings were ready, but our heart was not. We will hold on to the sweet memories and cherish them. You will forever be loved and missed until we meet again. I love you.
morning, everyone.
Sound of a mighty rushing wind, and it's closer now than it's ever been. I can almost hear the trumpet as Gabriel sounds the call, 'cause at the midnight cry, we'll be going home. I look around me and I see prophecies fulfilling everywhere. See, it's the signs of the times. They're appearing everywhere. I can almost hear the Father say, son, I'll go get my children, get my children. And at the midnight cry, the bride of Christ will rise. When Jesus steps out, Christ will rise to meet him in the air. And then those that remain shall be quickly we'll be going home. I look around me and I see prophecies fulfilling everywhere. It's the signs of the times. They're appearing everywhere. I can almost hear the Father say, son, go get my children, go get my children. 'Cause at the midnight cry, the bride of Christ will rise when Jesus steps out on the cloud to call his children. The dead Christ will rise to
dead in Christ will rise to meet him in the air. And then those that cry. Oh, at the midnight cry. Oh, at the midnight cry. We'll be going
the Lord. Thank you, Sherianne. And that song describes something that I look forward to, the great meeting in the air that those of us who claim Jesus as Lord and Savior will have with our sister Joyce one day in the future when Jesus returns to call his children home. And as the song says, those who are dead will precede those who are alive, and together we will be with the Lord Jesus Christ. When you know that Sister Jean is already in that Sister Joyce is already in that safe place, and that she is just awaiting us, it gives a hope and something to look forward to, that one day we will be reunited with our sister. Bless the name of the Lord. Let us bow our hearts in prayer. Father, we thank you that as we come this morning, as Deacon Lance would have said, we do not come as people without hope, because we understand that because our sister Joyce chose you to be her Lord and Savior, it means that one day we, Lord God, have the opportunity to meet with her again. We thank you, God, for giving us, Lord God, this hope. We thank you, Father God, for allowing us to understand that as we live for you as she did, that one day we will be together again. Father, as your word goes forth, I pray that it will touch hearts and lives. And God, I know that the desire of our sister's heart is that those whom she loves, that they too will be in a position as she is, where she can be with you today. So God, guide your servant. May the rest of this service bring honor and glory to your name, as has been done in the preceding time. Bless the name of the Lord. Before I get into the message, I must ask everyone needs to wear their mask and wear correctly, covering your nose and your mouth completely, please. We still are under the regulations that once we are in the building, that the mask must be worn. On behalf of Pastor Rosie Williams, founding pastor of the People's Cathedral, and her family, the Board of Deacons, the Board of Elders, and the members of this congregation, I extend sincerest condolences to the family and loved ones of Sister Joyce Alleyne, especially her sister Jean, and to Merlin and the rest of the siblings. And we continue to pray and lift you up and believe that God will strengthen you in this, your hour of bereavement. Today we have gathered to celebrate the life of Sister Joyce Alleyne, who was a faithful member of this church for several years. Until COVID interrupted, our sister Joyce sat over here on my left whenever she came, and I can see her now in her favorite seat sitting over there. Sister Joyce was never the type of member who demanded any attention, but you would just see her sitting down there smiling at you all the time, and in the moments when she could, giving you her support. She had some sweet words in her mouth when she needed to. I can't remember Sister Joyce ever with a frown, but as I mentioned before, she would be intent on the service, or she would have a smile on her face. When, as you heard, Merlin asked me to go over to pray for Sister Joyce, I counted it a privilege to make sure that I got there in sufficient time to minister to her. But the thing is, Sister Joyce ended up ministering to me because, as Melissa indicated, while she could not speak and respond to us, when we started to share the word and to minister in song, you could see the response from Sister Joyce and the fact that if she could, she would have joined us in the singing. But you saw her lips moving, you saw her eyes brighten up, and you saw her reaction to what was being done. And the reason it blessed me is because I saw it as a demonstration of the depth of her relationship with the Lord, and the fact that in that moment, when she was at that point of weakness, that this servant of God still held on, even just to the words of hymns and the word of the song that you heard in the pre-service and to the reading of the word. And it spoke to me that this was a woman who, until that moment, held on to her God and held on to that strong relationship with the Lord. And so I count it a privilege and honor this morning to be asked to officiate at her homegoing service of a beautiful servant of God. The sermon I will share with you is really an adaptation of a funeral service that was preached years ago by Charles Spurgeon. But to me, the depth of it is so rich that I wanted to use it for Sister Joyce's funeral today. The text is taken from Job chapter 5 and verse 26, and it reads, "You will go to the grave at a ripe old age, like a sheaf of grain harvested at the proper time." And to my mind, this portion of scripture, this text, really encapsulates what has taken place in Sister Joyce's life and how God brought her to that point in time and how he cared for her until that moment. You see, this verse of scripture tells us several things about the death of a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ. First, it tells us and reminds us that death is inevitable, because it says you will go, not you might go, not perhaps one day you may go, but it says definitively, you will go. Secondly, it tells us death is acceptable, because it does not read, I will make you go to your grave, but it says, you will go there, and I will expand on that. Also, this one line of scripture helps us to understand that death is timely. It says, you will go to the grave at a ripe old age. And it also helps us to understand that death to the Christian is always honorable. For the promise declares to him, you will go to the grave at a ripe old age, like a sheaf of grain harvested at the proper time. Our first point is that death is inevitable. This is simple and a fact of the cycle of life. Death will come to every single one of us. It doesn't matter what our socioeconomic status is. It does not matter what the religious persuasion is. Death will come. Hebrews 9:27 says, it is appointed unto all men once to die. So it isn't that some of us will face death and some of us will remain, but it is appointed. There is a set time in the life of everyone where we will meet death. And Romans 6:23 tells us why. says it is because the wages of sin is death. You see, our forefather Adam sinned and bequeathed to all of us the inevitability of death. And because Adam fell, he sent down to us through the generations the curse of death, and none of us can escape it. There is one exemption, and our sister Sherri-Ann sang about it a moment ago. We are told in scripture that there are some who shall be alive and remain when Jesus Christ returns to catch us away. And the Apostle Paul lays that out for us in 1 Corinthians 15, 51 to 52. He says, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep or die, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. And 1 Thessalonians 4:17 informs us, then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. However, some saints, like our dear sister Joyce, have already died in Christ. And they will go to a place where the laws of glory shall supersede the laws of nature. And therefore, one day will rise from the grave to meet the Lord. And so this tells us that death is carried to the other side. The wicked man, when he dies, is driven to his grave. But the Christian comes to his grave. And Spurgeon gave this illustration. He says, two men sat together in the same house. When death came to each of them, he said to one, thou shalt die. The man looked at him. Tears flooded his eyes, and tremblingly he said, oh death, I cannot, I will not die. He sought out a physician and said to him, I am sick, for death has looked upon me. His eyes have paled my cheeks, and I fear I must depart. Physician, there is my wealth. Give me health and let me live. The physician took his wealth, but did not give him his health, even with all his skill. The man changed his physician and tried another, and thought that perhaps he might spin out the thread of life a little longer. But alas, death came and said, I have given you time. Try varied excuses. Come with me. Thou shalt die. And he bound him hand and foot and made him go to that dark land of shades. As the man went, he clutched at every side post by the way, but death with iron hands still pulled him on. He did not come to his grave. He was dragged to his grave. The grave came to him. On the other hand, death said to the man who knew Christ, I have come for you. The man smilingly replied, ah, death, I know you. I have seen you many times. I have even held communion with you. But you are my master's servant. You have come to take me home. Go tell my master I am ready. Whenever he pleases, I am ready. Death, I am ready to go with thee. Do you see the difference? One man was dragged to the grave. Another, because he knew the Lord Jesus Christ, said to death, death, you've come for me, but you are my master's servant. You answer to my master. You can't drag me anyway. I go because my master beckons me. And this is not just an illustration. A nurse who is assigned to the cancer unit of the hospital once confirmed this for me. She told me that when her patients are on their deathbed, you can tell which ones are really Christians. She told me the ones who know Jesus usually go peacefully, some with a smile on their faces. Spurgeon summarizes the deathbed experience of a Christian this way. To them, death has been an agreeable visitor, of whom they were not afraid. And I believe this morning that our sister Joyce went on her own volition with death. She went with her angelic escorts when they came to take her home, because she understood where she was going.
She was not going to a place that she was afraid of. She knew that she was going home with her Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And so death did not have to take her kicking and screaming. Death was acceptable to our sister Joyce because she knew where and to whom she was going. For us who remain, this is a tough one to swallow. Because Sister Jean would still have her sister. Her children would still have their mother and the grandchildren, certainly their beloved grandparent. But when we understand that because Sister Jean knew Jesus, this was not something negative for her, but something acceptable in time, there comes an acceptance as well. Further to this, the Christian's death is timely. This verse says, you shall come to the grave at a ripe old age. And some of you are saying that is not always true. The most pious of men may die in the prime of their youth. However, Psalm 90 and verse 10 says, the days of our years are 70 years and 10. And if by reason of strength there be 80 years, yet is their strength labor and sorrow. For it is soon cut off and we fly away. Our sister Jean, by reason of her strength. Joyce, Jean, I'm not killing you off at all. Our sister Joyce. But it is just that when I think of one, I think of both. Our sister Joyce surpassed this 70 and 10. And the Lord gave her 20 extra years that she was with the Lord. And Psalm 91:16 also assures us with long life, God will satisfy us. And in other scriptures, it says that life is fleeting. And so our days might be few, but there are for some of us, that God sees fit to extend long life and gives those years. And he blessed our sister with those years. And you know, up until a few years ago, you would never guess that Sister Joyce was that age. When Sister Joyce was 80, I couldn't believe Sister Joyce was not 80, because she was still strong and vibrant, because she served her God and the Lord blessed Sister Joyce with long life. You can rest assured that a Christian will never die too soon. Our minds will probably go to many people and we will say, but they did die too soon. As I prepared this, I thought of my own sisters, both Christians. One of them died at the age of 12 and the other a few years ago, just short of her 50th birthday. And because of the pain of parting when they died, to me it was too soon. But in retrospect, when I thought about the fact that they belonged to Christ, I understood that it was in God's own timing and that for Christians, death was not too soon. God says they will come to him at a ripe old age, whatever he in his sovereign will determines that to be. Similarly, the Christian does not die too late. And we might say, but there is an old lady I know, or an old gentleman, who is well advanced in age and has to depend on others, might be poor and miserable. She and everyone else might be thinking, why doesn't God take that person home out of their suffering and misery? But we dare not find fault with God's decisions. According to Spurgeon, he is too good a husbandman to leave his wheat in the field too long. The challenge for us is this. As Sister Joyce's family did, go and minister to that person. Let them speak because they can tell you things you never knew about in life. And I'm sure that even as Sister Joyce was there on her deathbed, Sister Joyce was able to share nuggets with her family that they have never experienced before. when we visited Sister Joyce before her graduation to glory, you could see that in her. That from the time we read the word, the Psalms, she was right there with us. Why? As the word of God says, she had hidden the word of God in her heart all these years. She knew what psalm we was reading, and if we could have heard her voice, I know we would have heard Sister Joyce following along with us word for word, because that word was in her heart. And so she was ready for her Savior. Hear what God says to each of us. You shall come to the grave in full age. Sickness and disease sometimes come to drain our lifeblood from us, to dry up the very sap, the marrow from our bones. As a result, some people will say, Lord, how long? How long, Lord? Let me come home to you. They shall not, however, keep from our beloved Savior longer than necessary. They shall see heaven as soon as he deems it is they are ready for it. The Lord will say to them at that point, come up higher. When you have arrived at a full age, but never before or after. I am sure on the day that we visited Sister Jean, many who were there thought that was Sister Joyce. Many thought it was her last day. Sister Jean was there too, don't worry. They thought this is her last day. But Sister Joyce surprised us the next morning. Merlin messaged to say, Mommy is up. Sent pictures too. Mommy is up. And she is communicating with us. And the pictures had in Sister Joyce with a smile on her face. And we had thought she was going the day before. It tells us it is in God's own time. And he is the one who determines when the time is right. Moreover, a Christian will die with honor. They shall come to the grave like a shock of corn cometh in his season. Now, I'm not one who agrees with over extravagance when it comes to funerals, but I do believe there should not be, there shouldn't be unnecessary spending and so on, that it should be an honorable funeral. And all of us desires to have an honorable funeral. Most people prefer to be carried up the aisle with dignity by people who will truly miss them when they are gone. Therefore, our burial should not be like the one prophesied by Jehoiakim. And Jeremiah 22 and 18 says, the prophecy against Jehoiakim was this, they shall not lament for him saying, ah, my brother, or ah, sister. They shall not lament for him saying, ah, Lord, or ah, his majesty. With the burial of a donkey, he shall be buried, dragged and dumped beyond the gates of Jerusalem. However, for the Christian, the funeral, the homegoing service, the service of thanksgiving, whatever we want to call it, is honorable. Why? Because our Lord acknowledges it is his servant and lays it on the hearts of the family members to ensure that there is an honorable home going for the believer. And today we see that. We see the love that has been extended towards our departed sister, in that care has been taken with the selection of her coffin. Care has been even taken with this floral arrangement. It is beautiful. Care has been taken even by the family as they came here this morning, coordinating with the dressing. Care has been taken with the preparation of the tributes, whether they were in song or written. Because we all know that our sister was a child of God, and she carried herself like a child of God. And so as we come this morning, we've come to pay respect to her in an honorable way, as indeed is befitting to her because she is a child of God. God himself pays respect, says in Proverbs 10:7, the memory of the just is blessed. Psalm 116 and verse 15 says, the Lord cares deeply when his loved ones die. Revelation 14 also says, I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, write, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. You see, believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, like our sister Joyce Alleyne, will not be forgotten when they die. There will always be someone who will weep over her. She, like other believers who die in the Lord, will not be hurried away. This is why we are not hurrying down anything this morning, but will be carried with loving tears to her grave. There are always two ceremonies for every Christian at death. One, the funeral of the body of the mortal remains, and the other is the marriage of the soul. For as soon as her soul left her body, the angels stood ready to carry it away. They did not bring a fiery chariot like they did for Elijah, but I am sure there was a heavenly escort for our sister Joyce. As she went, her soul went to meet with her Lord and Savior. Luke 16:22 confirms this in the account of Lazarus' death, which says, the poor man died, and angels took him to the place of honor next to Abraham. And in my imagination, I can just see our sister Joyce resplendent as she was on the cover of this hymn sheet, dressed down to the nines and being escorted to meet her Lord. For you see, the death of a Christian is also honorable. And our Lord Jesus Christ takes particular care of his beloved. So, death for the believer in the Lord Jesus Christ is not only inevitable, it is acceptable, it is timely, and it is honorable. For those who have not given their lives to the Lord, I cannot say that this is a promise for you. I wish I could tell you that the last two things, timely and honorable, would be for you. It is inevitable for every single person. But for those who are not believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, death might not be acceptable, timely, or honorable. You see, these promises are only for those who have given their hearts to the Lord Jesus Christ as our sister did. However, by simply trusting in Jesus and giving yourself up to his mercy, even though you think right now that is something that is not for you, I guarantee you that when you give yourself to the Lord, there is a hope, there is a future, and even in death, there is a promise that death is acceptable, it is timely, and it is honorable. So, because I know it is what our sister Joyce would expect of us, before we close this service, I want to give opportunity, if there is anyone here this morning, and you would say, I want to take the example from this humble, strong, loving woman, and I would say, I will give my heart to the Lord. Lord, I want you as my Lord and Savior. I will take a moment to ask, while heads are bowed and eyes are closed and no one is looking around, is there a man, a woman, or a young person who will say this morning, Pastor, pray for me. I want to follow the example of Sister Joyce Alleyne. Give my heart to the Lord. If you are here and you want to make that decision, would you lift your hand? It is as simple as saying, Lord, I understand there are things in my life that are not right. I want you to forgive me of those things and remove them from my life. I want to give my heart and life to you. Or perhaps you once made that decision, but currently you are away from fellowship with the Lord and you want to renew that fellowship, would you quickly lift a hand and take it down? I will see that hand. I will pray for you. I will pray with you. Yes, I see that hand. Is there another? Yes, I see those hands. Who would say in this moment, yes, I want to ask Jesus to forgive me of my sin, and I want him to come into my heart and into my life. Following upon lifting that hand, there is another thing that I'm going to ask you to do. To say a simple prayer like this. For the Bible says that if we believe in our hearts that God raised Christ from the dead, and so he can be our Savior, and if we confess it with our mouths, we shall be saved. So I will ask of you to say a prayer like this. And if you believe it in your heart, the word of God says you shall be saved. This is what our sister did so many years ago and never turned back from it. So I'm going to ask you to follow after me, or you can say your own words that are similar to these. Please repeat. Lord Jesus, I know there are things in my life that are not right. Forgive me, Lord. Remove the sin from my life. Make me a new person.
Make me a new person.
I will live for you. And I will allow you to have control of my life. Thank you for this opportunity, Lord. And I ask that you will help me to live the life that you have in store for me. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Bless the name of the Lord. Just to repeat the scripture in your ear. By the way, if you've said that prayer and you've meant it, you are now a part of the family of God. And one day, the experience that Sherri-Ann sang about, when that meeting in the air happens, you will be reunited with our sister Joyce. Whether you will recognize her or not, I cannot say, but I know that we shall have that great meeting in the air. Job 5:26. You will go to the grave at a ripe old age, like a sheaf of grain harvested at the proper time. This is the testimony of our beloved sister today. At a ripe old age, with honor, like a sheaf of grain that was harvested at the perfect time, timely, with honor. And we thank God that he saw it fit to call our sister home unto himself, not in a way that we will remember and forever be heartbroken because we are not sure where she is, but that we know for certain our dear sister is with the Lord. And we thank God that one day we know we can join her too. I'm going to ask the family members to stand. I want to pray for you at this time. Death is difficult, and it is even more so when the one who has died is a beautiful soul, as our sister Joyce was. It is more so when it is a person who demonstrated such love and who gave so much of herself. And for some people will say, don't cry, don't grieve. But I say to you this morning, grief is healthy. A release of those feelings is healthy when you need to. Mourn for Sister Joyce as you need to, because indeed her death has left in all of our lives a significant vacuum that no one else can ever replace. But we will pray for you. We will stand with you as you go through these moments of bereavement. Father, I lift this family before you, the family of our dear sister Joyce Alleyne. God, you know all of them, each of them by name and by nature. Lord, you have numbered the very hair on their head, God, and you know them personally. And Father, you understand their grief, God. You understand the parting of our sister Joyce has left within them, Father God, feelings of hurt and pain. But this afternoon, God, you want them to know that you are with them, that you are there to comfort them in their time of bereavement, that you are there, Father God, to touch and to strengthen them when the memories return and the tears shall fall. And dear God, I ask that indeed in those moments, that their thoughts and eyes will be turned towards you. They would look to you, God, for their strength, and they would lean on each other, God, to bear one another up. Father, I pray that you will comfort, you will keep, you will strengthen, you will undergird, and you will surround this family in the name of Jesus. I pray especially for Sister Jean, oh God. And I pray, God, that you will encompass about her, God, and give her a special grace and strength, God, in the moments of her bereavement. God, that you will pour out your love upon her, God, in such a precious way that she will know you are right beside her every moment, holding her up. Father, I thank you that you are here, God, to provide comfort and strength in this moment. In Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Bless the name of the Lord. I'm going to ask the rest of the congregation to stand with us as we sing the recessional hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness. And I don't want us to sing it like if we are at a funeral. I want us to sing it as if we are truly celebrating the life of our sister Joyce, because she loved the hymns of the church. And we want, as we have the recessional, that this reflects the way that she would want us to sing this hymn on her behalf. Praise the Lord.
There is no shadow of turning, with
Dear Granny Joyce, it's been one of the hardest things to lose you because you meant so much to me. You're in my heart, and that's where you'll always be. I know that heaven called you, and I wish you could have stayed. But I know that the memories we have will never fade. We all knew it was time for you to go home so that all the pain you had could go away. But I want you to remember one thing. We're not apart. You will always be with us in our memories and in our broken hearts.
Hey, Granny. I just wanted to say thank you. Thank you for being such an amazing woman, such an amazing grandmother. Just thank you for everything that you were to our lives. You were an amazing person. I want to say thank you for teaching me that there is power in silence and there is pride in humbleness. And I want to say that I'm going to miss you so much. I don't think there's anything that will fill that void that you will leave, but I'm going to miss just the look on your face after months away overseas, coming home and seeing you smile. I'm going to miss your hugs. I'm going to miss your love. I'm going to miss your food. I'm just going to miss the way you held my hand, or you would hold my hand when I would walk you up the stairs, or I would walk you from church. I'm going to miss everything about you, Granny. And I just want to say that this is not our loss. This is heaven's gain. And until then, it's till we meet again. I love you, Granny.
My granny was a great cook. She would always have us in the kitchen with her on evenings or mornings, doing breakfast, lunch, sometimes dinner. We used to make curry chicken, fried rice, macaroni pie on Sundays, baked chicken. She always had us there under her, which inspired me to like go into doing like cooking and stuff. I like cooking because of my granny. Yeah, and I went to school for cooking. Granny's cooking inspired me. Even though I'm like far from home, it's like I always try to replicate the same dishes that she makes, but it's never like the same. Like it's more, whenever like I eat the food that Granny makes at home, it like it's more like homey and authentic than when I make it. So like that always like resonates with me, you know. But I always try to like get it as close to home as possible, like how Granny would make it back home. And like that's just something that I miss about like Granny in the whole, like in general, is like her cooking.
I'm Blake Clark. I'm one of Joyce's many grandchildren. Seeing her move on, I know she's gone to a better place. She's not in pain anymore. And like I said, well, Granny lived 90 years on the face of the earth, so. Granny got ill sudden. So it was like a shock to us. Because Granny's a lady that's strong. She goes out in the yard every morning, does her cleaning, she washes, she cooks. To see Granny like that, no, it was, as I said, it was a shocker. Although Granny's gone, she's still here with all of us. I told her the most important thing before she go, and that was they left her.
My name is Sandra, and I am the eldest daughter of Joyce Alleyne. Mom really liked cooking, and of such till unto this day, I always remember Mom when she cooked baked chicken. I could never get it the way how she cooked it, and I always want to taste it the way how she want, but I never get it to taste the way that way. But by such, it will happen one day. And Mom, as we grew up together, in addition, there were other children that Mom mind, and they would all come to her home, And if we would say that we had a friend and the friend was in need somewhere to stay, we just go and tell mom, and she said, oh, bring them along. And we all hold together in the house. And we will cook and eat and everything.
It would have been in the 1980s, 70s, 80s, right? When we were all teenagers, we would visit each other's house. Like I would spend, me and my sister with Valerie would spend time over at Uncle George and Aunt Joyce with their kids, or they would come vice versa, spend time with us over the West Coast in Guyana. And we all grew up as one family. There was never any distinction. I remember when we were in our adolescence, probably in our 20s, Sharon lived at us for about probably a year or over. And same thing, we were always treated as one. There was never any distinction. And this is why I saw it fitting. It was heartbreaking to hear of the death, and I saw it fitting to go to the funeral because I see myself as living at that house and living with that lady for some time. All right, because even when we went to Barbados for the family reunion, she remembered us, and the kind of welcome we got was no different to when we were in Guyana.
Even if people don't remember us as Miss Alleyne, they always remember the Buns lady daughter. She always make a good mean buns. She was just there. She's just mommy all the time, always at home. Good housewife.
3 weeks ago, she said, listen, I live my life. I'm ready to go home. She said, I said, mom, she said, listen, I raised 6 kids. I see my grandkids. I know my great grands. I did enough, you know. So I know my mother went home and she's comfortable, she's happy. I'm quite sure people who go to view her is gonna see she's at rest and she's, you know, she's happy where she at today.
My name is Dennis Greenidge. I am the fourth cousin of our late husband. Our late husband, mother and my mother were 2 sisters, and may she rest in peace. All the best, and I ask all our relatives to have faith in God. I know death is inevitable, but at the same time, when it comes, we cannot bear it. Life or death, life is like a story. It's like a story, never mind how long a story is, it has an end. Although we know life has an end, when it comes, we seldom want to accept it. That is a human nature, but we have to accept it. My deepest sympathy to all, my deepest sympathy. I share your sorrow, share your sorrow. Cousin Joyce, have an eternal rest, and may you find a place in the right arm of God. And may God have mercy upon your soul, and you rest in peace. Rest in peace. And all those who are left behind, or all those who are still remaining, I will like them to take a leaf from our book. Take a leaf and follow in our footsteps. Follow our way of our life, and that we may that live an exemplary life. And my deepest sympathy.
Dear Granny Joyce, it's been one of the hardest things to lose you because you meant so much to me. You're in my heart, and that's where you'll always be. I know that heaven called you, and I wish you could have stayed. But I know that the memories we have will never fade. We all knew it was time for you to go home so that all the pain you had could go away. But I want you to remember one thing. We're not apart. You will always be with us in our memories and in our broken hearts.
Hey, Granny, I just wanted to say thank you. Thank you for being such an amazing woman, such an amazing grandmother. Just thank you for everything that you were to our lives. You were an amazing person. I want to say thank you for teaching me that there is power in silence and there is pride in humbleness. And I want to say that I'm going to miss you so much. I don't think there's anything that will fill that void that you will leave, but I'm going to miss just the look on your face after months away overseas, coming home and seeing you smile. I'm going to miss your hugs. I'm going to miss your love. I'm going to miss your food. I'm just going to miss the way you held my hand, or you would hold my hand when I would walk you up the stairs, or I would walk you from church. I'm going to miss everything about you, Granny. And I just want to say that this is not our loss. This is heaven's gain. And until then, it's till we meet again. I love you, Granny.
My granny was a great cook. She would always have us in the kitchen with her on evenings or mornings, doing breakfast, lunch, sometimes dinner. We used to make curry chicken, fried rice, macaroni pie on Sundays, baked chicken. She always had us there on her, which inspired me to like go into doing like cooking and stuff. I like cooking because of my granny. Yeah, and I went to school for cooking. Granny's cooking inspired me. Even though I'm like far from home, it's like I always try to replicate the same dishes that she makes, but it's never like the same. Like it's more, whenever like I eat the food that Granny makes at home, it like it's more like homey and authentic than when I make it. So like that always like resonates with me, you know? But I always try to like get it as close to home as possible, like how Granny would make it back home. And like that's just something that I miss about like Granny in the whole, like in general, is like her cooking.
I'm Blake Clark. I'm one of Joyce's many grandchildren. Seeing her move on, I know she's gone to a better place. She's not in pain anymore. And like I said, we're grounded 90 years on the face of the earth, so. Grand got ill sudden. Grand got ill sudden, so it was like a shock to us. Because Gran is a lady that's strong. She goes over the yard every morning, does her cleaning, she washes, she cooks. To see Gran like that, no, it was, as they said, it was a shocker. Although Gran is gone, she's still here with all of us. I told her the most important thing before she go, and that was the leper.
My name is Sandra, and I am the eldest daughter of Joyce Alleyne. Mom really liked cooking, and of such till unto this day, I always remember Mom when she cooked baked chicken. I could never get it the way how she cooked it, and I always want to taste it the way how she want, but I never get it to taste the way that way. But by such, it will happen one day. And Mom, as we grew up together, in addition, there were other children that Mom mind, and we would all come to her home. And if we would say that we had a friend and the friend was in need somewhere to stay, we just go and tell Mom, and she said, "Oh, bring them along," and we all hold together in the house. And we will cook and eat and everything.
It would have been in the 1980s, 70s, 80s, right? When we were all teenagers, we would visit each other's house. Like me and my sister Valerie would spend time over at Uncle George and Aunt Joyce with their kids, or they would come vice versa, spend time with us over the West Coast in Guyana. And we all grew up as one family. There was never any distinction. I remember when we were in our adolescence, probably in our 20s, Sharon lived at us for about probably a year or over. And same thing, we were always treated as one. There was never any distinction. And this is why I saw it fitting. It's heartbreaking to hear of the death, and I saw it fitting to go to the funeral because I see myself as living at that house and living with that lady for some time. All right, because even when we went to Barbados for the family reunion, she remembered us, and the kind of welcome we got was no different to when we were in Guyana.
Even if people don't remember us as Miss Alleyne, they always remember the Buns lady daughter. She always make a good main buns. She was just there. She's just mommy all the time, always at home. Good housewife.
3 weeks ago, she said, listen, I live my life. I'm ready to go home. She said, I said, Mom, she said, listen, I raised 6 kids. I see my grandkids. I know my great grands. I did enough. You know, so I know my mother went home and she's comfortable. She's happy. I'm quite sure people who go to view her is going to see she's at rest and she's, you know, she's happy where she at today.
My name is Dennis Greenwich. I am the fourth cousin of our late husband. Our late husband, mother and my mother were 2 sisters. And may she rest in peace. All the best. And I ask all our relatives to have faith in God. I know death is inevitable, but at the same time, when it comes, we cannot bear it. Life or death, life is like a story. It's like a story. Never mind how long a story is, it has an end. Although we know life has an end, when it comes, we seldom want to accept it. That is a human nature. But we have to accept it. My deepest sympathy to all, my deepest sympathy. I share your sorrow. Share your sorrow. Cousin Joyce, have an eternal rest, and may you find a place in the right hand of God. And may God have mercy upon your soul. And you rest in peace. Rest in peace. And all those who are left behind her, all those who are still remaining, I will like them to take a leaf from our book. Take a leaf and follow in our footstep. Follow our way of our life. And that live an exemplary life. And my deepest sympathy.
Dear Granny Joyce, it's been one of the hardest things to lose you because you meant so much to me. You're in my heart, and that's where you'll always be. I know that heaven called you, and I wish you could have stayed. But I know that the memories we have will never fade. We all knew it was time for you to go home so that all the pain you had could go away. But I want you to remember one thing. We're not apart. You will always be with us in our memories and in our broken hearts.
Hey, Granny. I just wanted to say thank you. Thank you for being such an amazing woman, such an amazing grandmother. Just thank you for everything that you were to our lives. You were an amazing person. I want to say thank you for teaching me that there is power in silence, and there is pride in humbleness. And I want to say that I'm going to miss you so much. I don't think there's anything that will fill that void that you will leave, but I'm going to miss just the look on your face after months away overseas, coming home and seeing you smile. I'm going to miss your hugs. I'm going to miss your love. I'm going to miss your food. I'm just going to miss the way you held my hand, or you would hold my hand when I would walk you up the stairs, or I would walk you from church. I'm going to miss everything about you, Granny. And I just want to say that this is not our loss. This is heaven's gain. And until then, it's till we meet again. I love you, Granny.
My granny was a great cook. She would always have us in the kitchen with her on evenings or mornings, doing breakfast, lunch, sometimes dinner. We used to make curry chicken, fried rice, macaroni pie on Sundays, baked chicken. She always had us there under her, which inspired me to like go into doing like cooking and stuff. I like cooking because of my granny. Yeah, and I went to school for cooking. Granny's cooking inspired me. Even though I'm like far from home, it's like I always try to replicate the same dishes that she makes, but it's never like the same. Like it's more, whenever like I eat the at home, it like it's more like homey and authentic than when I make it. So like that always like resonates with me, you know. But I always try to like get it as close to home as possible, like how Granny would make it back home. And like that's just something that I miss about like Granny in the whole, like in general, is like her cooking.
I'm Blake Clark. I'm one of Joyce's many grandchildren. Seeing her move on, I know she's gone to a better place. She's not in pain anymore. And like I said, we're grounded 90 years on the face of the earth, so. Grand got ill sudden. Grand got ill sudden, so it was like a shock to us. Because Gran is a lady that's strong. She goes over in the yard every morning, does her cleaning, she washes, she cooks. To see Gran like that, no, it was, as I said, it was a shocker. Although Gran is gone, she's still here. With all of us. I told her the most important thing before she go, and that was they left her.
My name is Sandra, and I am the eldest daughter of Joyce Alleyne. Mom really liked cooking, and of such till unto this day, I always remember Mom when she cooked baked chicken. I could never get it the way how she cooked it, and I always want to taste it the way how she want, but I've never get it to taste the way that way. But by such, it will happen one day. And Mom, as we grew up together, in addition, there were other children that Mom mind, and we would all come to her home. And if we would say that we had a friend and the friend was in need somewhere to stay, we just go and tell Mom, and she said, oh, bring them along. And we all hold together in the house. And we will cook and eat and everything.
It would have been in the 1980s, 70s, 80s, right? When we were all teenagers, we would visit each other's house. Like I would spend... Me and my sister with Valerie would spend time over at Uncle George and Aunt Joyce with their kids, or they would come vice versa, spend time with us over the West Coast in Guyana. And we all grew up as one family. There was never any distinction. I remember when we were in our adolescence, probably in our 20s, Sharon lived at us for about probably a year or over. And same thing, we were always treated as one. There was never any distinction. And this is why I saw it fitting It was heartbreaking to hear of the death, and I saw it fitting to go to the funeral because I see myself as being as living at that house and living with that lady for some time. All right, because even when we went to Barbados for the family reunion, she remembered us, and the kind of welcome we got was no different to when we were in Guyana.
Even if people don't remember us as Miss Alleyne, they always remember Buns' lady daughter. She always make a good mean buns. She was just there. She's just mommy all the time, always at home, good housewife.
3 weeks ago, she said, listen, I live my life. I'm ready to go home. She said, I said, Mom, she said, listen, raise 6 kids. I see my grandkids. I know my great grands. I did enough, you know? So I know my mother went home and she's comfortable. She's happy. I'm quite sure people who go to view her is going to see she's at rest and she's, you know, she's happy where she at today.
My name is Dennis Greenwich. I am the fourth cousin of our late husband. Our late husband, mother and my mother were two sisters. And may she rest in peace. All the best. And I ask all our relatives to have faith in God. I know death is inevitable, but at the same time, when it comes, we cannot bear it. Life or death, life is like a story. It's like a story. Never mind how long a story is, it has an end. Although we know life has an end, when it comes, we seldom want to accept it. That is a human nature. But we have to accept it. My deepest sympathy to all, my deepest sympathy. I share your sorrow. Share your sorrow. Cousin Joyce, have an eternal rest, and may you find a place in the right hand of God. And may God have mercy upon your soul. And you rest in peace. Rest in peace. And all those who are left behind her, all those who are still remaining, I will like them to take a leaf from our book. Take a leaf and follow in our footstep. Follow our way of our life. And that live an exemplary life. And my deepest sympathy.
Dear Granny Joyce, it's been one of the hardest things to lose you because you meant so much to me. You're in my heart and that's where you'll always be. I know that heaven called you and I wish you could have stayed, but I know that the memories we have will never fade. We all knew it was time for you to go home so that all the pain you had could go away. But I want you to remember one thing, we're not apart. You will always be with us in our memories and in our broken hearts.
Hey, Granny. I just wanted to say thank you. Thank you for being such an amazing woman, such an amazing grandmother. Just thank you for everything that you were to our lives. You were an amazing person. I want to say thank you for teaching me that there is power in silence, and there is pride in humbleness. And I want to say that I'm going to miss you so much. I don't think there's anything that will fill that void that you will leave, but I'm going to miss just the look on your face after months away overseas, coming home and seeing you smile. I'm going to miss your hugs. I'm gonna miss your love. I'm gonna miss your food. I'm just gonna miss the way you held my hand, or you would hold my hand when I would walk you up the stairs, or I would walk you from church. I'm gonna miss everything about you, Granny. And I just wanna say that this is not our loss. This is heaven's gain. And until then, it's till we meet again. I love you, Granny.
My granny was a great cook. She would always have us in the kitchen with her on evenings or mornings, doing breakfast, lunch, sometimes dinner. We used to make curry chicken, fried rice, macaroni pie on Sundays, baked chicken. She always had us there on her, which inspired me to like go into doing like cooking and stuff. I like cooking because of my granny. Yeah, and I went to school for cooking.
Granny's cooking inspired me. Even though I'm like far from home, it's like I always try to replicate the same dishes that she makes, but it's never like the same. Like it's more, whenever like I eat the food that Granny makes at home, it like it's more like homey and authentic than when I make it. So like that always like resonates with me, you know. But I always try to like get it as close to home as possible, like how Granny would make it back home. And like that's just something that I miss about like Granny in the whole, like in general, is like her cooking.
I'm Blake Clark. I'm one of Joyce's many grandchildren. Seeing her move on, I know she's gone to a better place. She's not in pain anymore. And like I said, we're grounded 90 years on the face of the earth, so. Grand got ill sudden. Grand got ill sudden, so it was like a shock to us. Because Gran is a lady that's strong. She goes over in the yard every morning, does her cleaning, she washes, she cooks. To see Gran like that, no, it was, as they said, it was a shocker. Although Gran is gone, she's still here with all of us. I told her the most important thing before she go, and that was they left her.
My name is Sandra, and I am the eldest daughter of Joyce Alleyne. Mom really liked cooking, and of such till unto this day, I always remember Mom when she cooked baked chicken. I could never get it the way how she cooked it, and I always want to taste it the way how she want, but I never get it to taste the way that way.
there, I suppose, is supposed to hug the lady on the shoulder. That's why you go and take them over.
So that she can walk properly.
So that, and then if she fall, you could lift she. Mm-hmm. That's why they go and take it over.
And she can
Be careful that part behind us, right? Be careful that part behind your head.
Thank you.
We shall now commence with our committal service. We brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we can carry nothing out. The Lord gave, and the Lord hath given away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then it shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? Father, we've come to the final resting place of our dear beloved Sister Joyce Alleyne. Dear God, even as we lay her mortal remains to rest, we ask that you, in your providence, will come alongside this family to strengthen, to uplift, God, to encourage, to keep, God. And we pray, God, that even as we have testified of her life and witness this day, that they too will remember with joy the many wonderful times that they have spent with your beloved servant, and that those memories will sustain them, God, over the months and years as they continue, Lord God, to mourn her loss. Father, we ask for your strength in this moment, God, for our sister and the life that she lived before you. Father, we thank you for the blessing that she has been to so many of us. And God, we commit her back into your hand in this moment, God, in the way that you gave her to us. For as much as it hath pleased our Heavenly Father, in his wise providence to take unto himself our beloved Joyce Alleyne, we therefore commit her body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. In committing this body to the grave, the dust returns to the earth as it was. The spirit has gone to God. We shall now have the singing of the hymn, On Christ the Solid Rock I Stand, All Other Ground is Sinking Sand. Oh,
Oh, and his praise. In the mansions bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing and forgiving. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. While we walk the pilgrim, spread the sky. But when traveling days are over, now we all shall know the sky. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing and forgiving. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Serving every day, just one glimpse of him in glory will the toils of life repay. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Onward to the prize before us, soon his beauty will behold. Soon the pearly gates will open, we shall tread the streets of gold. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all
me.
Let us pray. Father, we thank you for the many shared and precious memories that we have had with our wonderful sister. We cherish these blessed memories, Lord, at this time. We thank you for her faithfulness and for her friendship. We thank you for her consecrated life. And now, Lord, as we lay her body to rest and as we leave her in your care, we ask you, dear God, that you will continue to comfort her loved ones, surround them and guard them with your peace that passeth all understanding. And Lord, we thank you for that blessed hope we have that one day we shall see our sister again. Thank you for that comfort, Lord. And now, Father, we pray that you will bless and that you will keep your mighty hand upon these, her loved ones and friends. Though the Lord bless you and keep you, the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and grant you his peace now and forevermore. Amen. Amen.
No, she's not.
No, don't put the brooch. You might. 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 You might